Hi, my name is Robert Vankirk. I'm here with Mike Johnson, and we're here to talk about Mike. So, welcome, Mike. First question, as always, is can you tell me a little bit about yourself, your history, where you grew up?
I grew up in a small town of Verdon, New Mexico, and attended school all my life in Duncan, Arizona. I lived there, graduated there. It's a small, rural, agricultural town, just about maybe 150 to 200 miles north of the Mexican border. I grew up with many Hispanics, many immigrants there, especially with their parents working in the local fields. For some of my other classmates, I actually did own some of the farmlands, and they did have trouble speaking English and everything, but the environment that we lived in, families and generations had always been so and done so. I grew up with my family being there and working on farmlands as well, but they had always been pretty prominent in speaking English. They did own farmland and fields themselves, but most of the time they spent their time working in others' fields and farmlands to make money and make a living.
So what was the community like where you grew up?
It was very small town feel to it. There was, I believe, 800 people within a 30-mile radius. So everyone knew each other. Everyone knew who would move into town or who would be the first ones to move out, knew everyone's family's business. It was a very comfortable feeling. We didn't really have any racial problems as far as things go, because it was either a mix between the heavy Hispanic community or Mormon settlers that had moved in. And they were very comfortable and very welcoming with anyone who would ever come in.
That's nice. So what is your family's roots in that area like? Like, how long have they lived there for?
My family had lived in Arizona for probably about 3 generations.
So where were they from before that?
Before that, my grandparents had, there was a mix of them that one side came from Mexico and immigrated from Mexico, and my grandfather's side hailed from Spain and traveled from there. They had either struck some deal or they had made some sort of a huge investment over here, which they were sitting pretty well off of, but my great-grandmother didn't want anything to do with money, so she chose to start from the ground up and decided she wanted to be working in the fields with her husband, who she fell in love with. And my grandmother's side, my great-grandmother, well, my great-great-grandmother on that side, she wound up coming and immigrating from Mexico so my great-grandmother could have a better lifestyle.
Okay. So you have some family history then in the area. I guess what I was trying to also get at was, did your family live there when it was actually Mexico? Because the U.S. kind of immigrated over Mexico. Or over, yeah.
So they had been living there since before Arizona became a state in 1912.
Okay.
So whenever it was still the Arizona and New Mexico territory.
Okay. But they lived there when it was still a part of Mexico, right?
Correct.
Yeah. So what compelled you to move to Michigan?
Whenever I was in during my senior year, I was looking at a bunch of the universities throughout the nation. I was getting pretty good scholarships for as active as I was in the work that I was doing. And it was a lot more affordable. And at the time, I was also seeing someone that kind of influenced that decision, but again, more so the cost of living whenever I was looking at it, the metropolitan area as well for what it was worth, also kind of influenced that. I was also, I graduated with my certification for pharmacy technician, and also got my licensure. So I was also looking at states that paid the most for their pharmacy technicians. Michigan,
nice.
Then at the time, happened to be one of the states that did so.
Okay. So you mentioned that you were pretty active and that's what got you scholarships. What did you do in high school that got you scholarships?
In high school, I participated in programs, FBLA, which is Future Business Leaders of America, my first 2 to 3 years. It's similar to FFA, Future Farmers of America, but it's the business side of things. Mm-hmm. Another program I did was HOSA with the pharmacy tech program that I was involved with. It's Health Occupation Students of America. They actually, same thing as FFA and FBLA, it's competing statewide, and then if you make it statewide, you can make it to nationals and earn a title there and receive sometimes great scholarships if you place nationally in at a high level.
Nice.
Another program that I was involved with was the student government body. I served as the vice president and secretary most of all 4 years of my high school career. And another program that I was also involved with was I lived out in New Mexico, so I went to school in Arizona. The state had to have cross-funding for us students. Every couple of years, legislation in Arizona, New Mexico would have to agree to paying students outside of the state, in-state tuition, and accommodating us with buses and funding for traveling to and from school. So we would always have to fight when they were trying to make us go to school in New Mexico. And the reason why we had to fight for that was the school that I went to in Arizona was only about 15 miles away. And the school that they were wanting us to go to in New Mexico was about 40 to 50 miles away.
Mm, bit of a difference.
So it was a huge difference, especially with the programs and the college that worked with my local high school. Basically, all the pluses that you would get out of it, it wasn't worth going to New Mexico and losing that funding. So I would fight for that, meet with local legislation at our town halls and city meetings, and write letters to them with a couple of my other classmates, convincing them that this was essential that we stay in the position that we were in at the moment.
Okay, so you had a history of community advocacy in Arizona, right? So what compelled you to get active here in West Michigan?
I think with the elections with Trump and the way things were heading, as far as looking every day on my social media, looking every day at my news headlines in my phone and seeing how bigoted decisions and racism were affecting the country. It was something I didn't want to just sit by and watch. It was something I actually wanted my people to represent, and it's something that kind of awakened out of me from seeing, just remembering that my great-grandparents and the lineage of history that I have, they've always fought and worked hard for everything that they've had. And that's not something that I'm willing to lose.
So what's some of the ways that you've gotten active here in West Michigan?
Some of the ways I've gotten active is I first got my feet wet with Grand Rapids United Progressives and getting more involved with the politics through them and kind of seeing how they branch out to other groups and associate with them working on rallies or educating people on issues that are going on and getting them to register and vote in local millages, polls, and politics that they're doing.
Okay.
And learning about the candidates that they support.
Okay, do you do anything else?
I did decide to run recently as well for county commission. Previously was running for school board. So because education was always a huge part of my life, and I've always felt like as long as you can get students that access and make it easier for them to work their way from high school and bridge the gap to college and let them know that no matter what, it's always worth it to finish whatever degree program, whatever certificate program. That's why I decided to do school board, but I more recently chose county commission because there was an opening available for it. I didn't have a primary against myself, and I figured that it would be a great way to step into a partisan politic election.
Well, before we talk about politics, don't you also do work with the Grand Rapids Pride Center?
I do work with the Grand Rapids Pride Center. I am a youth facilitator volunteer there. A major part that made me want to participate, volunteer, and educate the kids was, again, the bigotry that was going on, the racism that was going on as well with the direction America was heading, and I wanted to make sure that the youth group that I'm participating with and facilitating, that they knew that that's not the way it's going to be forever, that they have a voice and that they're the ones that can change this down the road.
But, like, what is the Pride Center?
The Pride Center is a huge resource to the LGBTQ community.
What does that mean?
It provides...
What is the LGBT community? Pretend that I don't know.
Okay. So, any person or kid that may associate as lesbian, bi, transgender, gay, queer, or anything thereof, there's asexual, there's non-binary, there is also different forms of transgender. So anything that they associate with beyond being a heterosexual, which we also welcome heterosexuals as well, that way they can learn and educate themselves on how to support their friends. We welcome them to come to the Pride Center. There is also on-site counseling for bullying or any sort of depression or issues that our students or kids may be going through, or even young adults and adults. We do offer all those free services. They're completely confidential. And it's basically, they call most of the groups their support groups, but as far as my youth group goes, I always tell people that I see it as the LGBTQ version of a YMCA. It's a place where they come and have fun, decompress, and just learn to grow their connections. And actually, they've been active with each other in their schools, setting up, they set up the gay straight alliances with their local high schools. And some of the kids don't even go to these schools that they do set up the gay straight alliances, but they show up to support their friends and show up to support those that they know. So it's really good to see that connection growing strong and them sticking up for each other as well.
So why is it important to have a Pride Center? Why even have it?
It is a safe haven for the kids to come to.
Why do they need a safe haven?
They don't feel safe going to their school's YMCAs or their church's YMCAs, because their church's YMCAs typically discriminate against the choices or their lifestyles on how they're living. So the Grand Rapids Pride Center provides them with that safe haven, with that just natural feel for them to participate in something where others can also associate with them or can discuss similar issues or problems that are going on with them.
Okay, so can you talk a little bit about more about why a young person might desire to go to the Pride Center and the work that you might be able to help them with?
A young person might decide to go to the Pride Center because we do offer health services that are completely confidential as well. We do very close work with Red Project. We do promote and educate the kids on the safety of having safe sex. We also do bring in someone from the local health department. And we also work closely with local doctor's offices as well that do support the LGBTQ community.
And so why can't those kids just go to their own doctor or to go to a community health clinic or whatever?
Unfortunately, there is a lot of local doctors and community clinics that still do discriminate against the LGBTQ community. That's something that we're working on. putting out there and growing those connections. So at the Pride Center, we do have a list of doctors that do strongly support the LGBTQ community. Mm-hmm. When they do come out and talk, they talk about programs such as PrEP. They talk about if you are a victim of sexual assault or domestic violence, which a lot of our youth does experience at being in the situations that they're in. Mm-hmm. The counselors also work with these doctors as well on the depression with the kids. They obviously do have to report anything that is serious to the state that we experience. But again, we're there to create a safe haven for the kids, make them feel welcomed, and let them know that they always do have someone behind them and someone that's got their back.
Okay. Would you say that they have a sense of community in their schools, or would they find a sense of community at the Pride Center?
They find a sense of community at the Pride Center. There's a reason why our numbers are growing. But then again, we are a huge resource as well, so that's why we do push for them to establish gay-straight alliances at their school. Some it's harder than others to obviously do, but we're always asking and promoting that they do the activism on their end too, to get and educate people. And that's the biggest thing, is just education. The more people are educated, the better understanding that they will have for our community, the LGBTQ community.
So I recently, I think I remember hearing about a Catholic high school in Grand Rapids that was not allowing a gay-straight alliance to form. Can you talk a little bit about why the Pride Center might be important for students that go to a parochial school like a Catholic high school, that they could have a sense of community at the Pride Center versus at a high school that has forbidden them from having that sense of community?
We actually have a couple of students from Catholic Central High School that do attend the Pride Center. They were a part of that movement that was trying to get set up there. Mm-hmm. It was a little bit of a disappointment for them. But the thing is, they still knew that they had the Pride Center to come back to, and it didn't discourage them from helping others try to set up gay-straight alliances to their schools, whether they be Christian or just public schools as well.
So I think talking about your LGBT identity is important, and then we can also talk about your Hispanic identity and I think politics later on. But so how would you say that your LGBT identity has contributed to your experience of the needs of others and motivated you to take action, like join the Pride Center, like to help them?
I think growing up in that small town and small community where everyone knew each other, where I'm from, being LGBTQ was definitely frowned upon. It was considered taboo, really, and that's the way it was treated. It was small town in the late 2000s, but the mindset was still 1940s, 1950s rhetoric, where you don't talk about it, everything's brushed underneath the rug. That made me feel really uncomfortable as an individual. It was a skin that you were living in daily that you sometimes couldn't face. Sometimes it would be a huge anxiety. And as involved as I was with the community and always being a face out there, always facing the school board, always facing locally elected officials, working with the mayor on different things, I think, and my family already having a big name, I didn't want to disappoint them. I didn't want to disappoint the community. So it was a heavy burden, that something that you just kept locked away and you almost felt ashamed for it. And after moving here and coming out and feeling more comfortable with myself, I didn't want other kids or individuals to experience that. And I want to know it's okay to be who you are. And you should feel comfortable in the skin that you have.
So how would you say that your family has reacted to you being LGBTQ?
They've always associated LGBTQ with that small town mindset, as in you go to the club and party a lot, you don't have responsibilities, you get yourself into debt, you make horrible decisions, which is a really negative persona to put on our community. There's many successful individuals that are out there, whether it be that rock star in Hollywood or whether it be a very political activist on the other side of it. But I think the main thing is that times are changing, and I think what made them realize is you're with me being gay, and I think what kind of normalized it for them in their eyes is that I own a house, I pay taxes just like everyone else and pay my bills just like everyone else, have a job, drive my own car, pay car insurance. I'm just another person. It doesn't really say much more than that.
Could you share the story, if you're comfortable, of your coming out to your parents?
Yeah. So when I did come out to my parents, I had moved up here and I still wasn't out of the closet in a sense. I told them I was coming up here for school, but I really was moving up here for one of my previous lovers, and it just happened to be on my mother's birthday that I decided that I wanted to tell her, and I just had to let it out. Was it the right choice for me to probably do? No, it probably wasn't the right setting, but I did it while she was in a van with my grandmother's, my sister, and one of our cousins, I believe. So it did go a little rocky for a couple of weeks.
She's a little loud, so I'm presuming everyone else found out.
And it was on speaker. So.
That's great.
But besides that, I mean,
did you know that you were on speaker?
No.
Okay. So maybe for future generations, check and see if your parents are on speaker before you out yourself to them. If that's something that you're concerned with. So, okay.
Or if it's only one individual that you want to know.
Yeah. So why did you select your mother to come out to first?
I've always felt more comfortable with females in my family. Growing up, it's that kind of nurturing. I know way back in the day when, back whenever my mom had had me and she was going through the struggles that she was going through.
Like what? What kind of struggles?
So my real dad had left her and divorced her, and she was going through court with him and everything. She didn't really have a place to stay, so her parents were the ones that had taken us in, completely watched over us, and ever since she met my stepdad, which he's always been my dad because he came into my life about 6 months in.
Is that where you get Johnson as a last name?
Yes. That's where I get Johnson from, a last name. She had met him about 6 or 7 months after I was born, and the divorce was happening the moment I was born up until 3 or 4 months after. My grandparents had always, because of that struggle, my grandparents have always made it a staple to be there no matter what for me, always take me in. So my dad right now, he's a great and one, I have no words to explain how much he's truly done for me and done for people that have been involved with mine and my sister's life. But my grandparents have also just, they've been like another set of parents to me, really. And being that I lived 15 miles from my school, they lived in town. So anytime I'd had school functions or anything, they'd have a room set up for me. They'd make breakfast, make sure that I was well fed before I went to these events, made sure I was getting enough sleep, and would help me out by driving me to and from wherever I needed to be for school functions, always being there for my sports or athletics events that I would do. So they were basically that crowd that was always cheering me on.
So how do you feel like that family support has helped you with your community engagement here in Michigan?
I feel like that family support has helped me because my grandfather ran for sheriff back in the day when I was a lot younger. And he wound up getting under sheriff. He didn't get sheriff, but he wound up getting that position, and he worked it for a while. So I was involved a little bit with his campaign. I was maybe about 3 or 4, but I was that cute little baby that he would hold whenever he was out campaigning. And
photo ops.
And I would wear his, he had a very extra small shirt for me that said Herrera for sheriff.
Aww.
And I still remember.
And you still have the shirt.
I still have the shirt. I do still remember him bringing home like little American flags that he had bought. So whenever he was going door knocking and canvassing, that he would hand out little American flags as well at the same time. I think that community engagement as well comes in because his brother worked for the local post office. So he would drive the truck from Globe, Arizona, all the way to Safford, Arizona. And from Safford, he would deliver mail that was sorted there to our town every other Saturday or so. So they all knew a lot of the local community members. And anytime there was an issue or a struggle, they were definitely not afraid to speak up. And I think that's where I got it from, was them and just watching their activism in my community as well. And my grandmother, being a special education teacher, she knew a lot of the, being that it was small again, she took care of basically all the disabled individuals that were young and in school in the community, knew their parents, knew their backgrounds, knew their families. And so that sense as well kind of pushed me to become active as well.
Okay. How would you feel, like, how would you say that your community involvement has shaped the policy positions that you're running on?
I think the what's also shaped my policy positions is just the work that I did as well. I also was a piano teacher whenever I was a lot younger, so I would see whenever you were setting something up like that and teaching piano, it's like, what kind of pricing can I do that would be affordable for parents with what wages they're making locally? I mean, not everyone was at all terribly rich, unless you were the local county attorney or unless you were the county judge. You're making money, but besides that, everyone else was kind of struggling or lower middle class. I definitely would consider my family to have been middle class to lower middle class, depending on what era it was that we were going through. Mm. But like I said, part of that reason, like whenever I was teaching music, I decided I could be making $5 to $10 a lesson on each of my students that I was teaching, or I could do something that's not going to rob the bank for parents and something that they could, I mean, living in the middle of nowhere, it also costs gas to drive out to where you needed to be. So I had an individual student that his family would drive about 30 minutes to receive these lessons, and I only charged, I think, $2 or $3 per lesson. I wasn't making anything away from it, but I think what really made it worth it was just that education aspect of it, being that arts weren't really involved heavily in my school. And I think that's another part what made me want to get engaged and active, as well as seeing those arts programs definitely boosted, and it helped me out dramatically. It was a stress reliever, making sure ensuring and protecting the funding for arts programs in schools. I grew up where it was always heavily about sports and making cuts to the band program, making cuts to wood shop, or even if it had to do with computer-aided drafting as well. They were always making cuts to that funding, and we were always, the teachers, which were very diligent and active, they were always applying for grants and funding on their own through the state or national accredited programs to get equipment, get new software. And I don't necessarily want to see a lot of the teachers that do good like that struggle like that. Struggle like how my school did. They should have appropriate funding and sources for the community that they're surrounded by.
Okay. So I feel like I went down a rabbit hole a little bit. But so what can you talk about the office that you're running for and what compelled you to run for that position? Right, we talked a little bit about your interest in running for county commission, but can you elaborate on that a little bit more?
So for county commission, I chose that because, like I said before, I was running for school board, but then I still wanted to run for a partisan race, get my feet wet, see what that was going to be like, see what the climate was for that. County commission, they basically there's a board of them. There's, I believe, 19 that sit on the current county commission. There's 13 districts. They oversee the city's budget and redistribute it.
The county, you mean?
The county's budget. They oversee the county's budget. They oversee redistributing the funds for all the local taxes, making sure that they hold at least a cushion or a backup funding. And after they establish that, they divide the remainder of that funds between all the local public departments through the county. They also work on giving out some funding to departments that may be in need of or asking of, may possibly like if the health department comes asking for some funding, it's typically voted on.
So like the recent cuts to mental health care services in the county?
Correct. If they were to go to the Board of Commissioners and ask...
Well, it's the Board of Commissioners that cut it.
If they do decide that they need to put funding into other areas that they feel are important, it is their decision to cut that funding and marginalize it, if you will, to reallocate it or conserve it.
Okay. So a county, so why is a county commission important in someone's life?
A county commission is important because they do decide on basically how your local property, everything that you're paying for property tax and everything that you're paying for your local taxes. It's, we're responsible for how that's going to get spent, basically.
Okay, so I think there's a lot of people out there that are really frustrated with government because they feel like it's not worked for them for a very long time. So how, what's your view of government? What should government be concerned with doing?
I think government should be concerned about making all their actions transparent, where all those taxpayers' dollars are going to.
Okay.
I think that if they do lend it out, that there should be some transparency and follow through with how it's getting spent. Because I think that's one of the people's biggest concerns is how are my tax dollars being spent?
But is it coming back into... Where should that money go?
I think it should go back into... I mean, obviously people are electing their officials for a particular reason, but I think the issues that people are platforming on should really be held accountable, and I think that they should really be putting those that money. Some are appealing to the public parks, and a great number of our parks here in the local community are not up to par. They're not staffed properly, and I think that's a big concern of the community is making sure that the parks are kept clean, making sure that the bathrooms are well established.
Does the county have anything to do with roads?
County does have a lot to do with roads as well, and working with the State Department as well with MDOT and making sure that we do fill all our potholes, making sure that our roads are drivable, which many are not. Mm-hmm. People are having to replace their tires often.
So that's something that me as a taxpayer, as somebody that lives in Wyoming, that lives in the Kent County, I'd be concerned with a county commissioner because the quality of the roads that I drive on is in part determined by the county commission.
Certainly, and that's something that hasn't been pushed as a great concern, great effort, especially with the way the winters have been and with the snow plows going along the roads. That does cause greater harm to our roads. I think that the current Board of Commissioners loses its focus with many of the other issues going on. It is a great importance and significance with the water contamination that's going on from the Wolverine Project, but we can't lose our focus on tackling other issues in the community. That's why there's so many board members. Yeah. It's so we don't lose that focus.
So, obviously, all the programs that you talked about cost money. Would you feel like what is your approach to taxes? Do you think that everyone should pay an equal bit into the pot, or do you feel like those that have a lot should maybe pay a little bit more than those that have very little?
I feel that it should be those that are on that supposedly top 1% should be paying more, or those that are making more money in their income should be taxed at the same level that someone, say, lower class to middle class is being taxed at.
I'm sorry, you think that people should be taxed at the same rate no matter how much money they
make? No, I think that those that are making a greater and significant amount of money should be taxed a little bit heavier than those that are lower class and middle class.
Okay, so one of the things in Michigan, they prevent a graduated income tax, so what we just described, but property taxes are a different story, right? So if your property is assessed at a certain level, then you're taxed at that level that it's assessed at. So property that's worth a lot more money, and typically that means people that have wealthier, a lot more money, would be taxed at a greater rate, and that property taxes then goes in and fuels the programs that you were talking about. So you agree with that policy that the wealthier folks should pay a little bit more money no matter how that shakes out, and those folks that have the least shouldn't be paying as much money into that system.
Correct.
So your priorities as a county commissioner then would be to focus on the working people of Kent County, right, and of Northern Wyoming and the city of Granville, and not necessarily the folks that have the most in our society.
Correct.
Okay. How is it that you would, how would your policies that you're putting forward actually impact people's lives for the better? You know, you've said that you're interested in working for the people, so how is it that your policies could reflect that and actually help people?
I think one of the major things, too, that I'm also trying to platform off of and ensure, just for my bloodline and lineage being a Hispanic, is the transparency of the local county jail.
Okay. What's the issue with the jail?
With the jail, I attended recently, within the last couple of months, a 911 meeting over at Ramblewood. I spoke with them. I mean, we spoke with one of the officers there, and she made it very clear that she was wondering why the Hispanic community was always afraid to contact the local police department. They were trying to work with them on reporting crime, reporting issues to the police department, but she explained to us a story that was very disturbing, saying that this father had his daughter running away constantly, and she was always willing to respond to that call and always going to get the daughter and bringing her back home, making sure she was safe and letting the father know that it was taken care of. Whether she had run away to a friend's house or just run away to downtown. So one of the very last times that he had called her, she had showed up to take the report from him, just like usual, but she noticed that he was intoxicated and had asked him on his front porch if he had driven home in the middle of this questioning. So he did state to her that he drove home, but there was no proof or evidence that he had driven. She didn't have that. It was just all by word of mouth. Mm-hmm. And she knew of his status as an immigrant, and she worked with the local county jail as soon as she took him in and let them know and made them aware to them that he had an ICE warrant out for him. And she was still in shock why the Hispanic community was wondering why the police department wasn't, she was wondering why they were so afraid of the police department. And I think the biggest thing there is that they felt like it was a huge shot in the dark to them.
Well, what happened to him?
He wound up being deported.
Okay.
So that essentially broke a family apart. And especially with the way this current administration is acting upon immigrants or foreigners, the community has been very afraid. The Hispanic community, at least, has been very afraid to step out, even to participate in voting. Has just showing up to the polls, they are afraid to be taken away and deported for a right that they have earned and many have fought for.
Well, I don't think the issue is that undocumented people are showing up to the polls to vote. I think the issue is U.S. citizens who are here, who are going to vote, are concerned about their relatives who are at home, who may be targeted because they just cast their vote, right? I think that's the real issue.
And I think the other part that frustrates me about that, too, is that they are all taxpayers. They all have working class jobs. So their money is going back into the community. And I think a big part of what needs to go on is educating our government workers on how to get them into legal status, working with them to create programs countywide that will help bridge that gap, so we're not tearing families apart, so we're not handling issues like that. That way we make the community more comfortable with reporting crimes that are going on in the areas.
Do you have experience from Arizona relating to law enforcement's treatments of immigrant communities?
I have actually experienced racial profiling myself. I'm sure most people know about Joe Arpaio. He was just recently pardoned within the last year by Trump. He was a huge sheriff out of Maricopa County in Arizona. He worked with Jan Brewer, the local, well, the governor at the time in Arizona, on a very discriminating policy. When the border issues were going on, he had pushed for legislation and crafted bills with some of the legislators as well. And they made it bipartisan as well, because there were some Democrats in the state that did vote on it as well. But he got a legislation piece passed where local law enforcement, whether they be state troopers or local county police officers, they could come up to an individual off the street or sidewalk if they had reasonable suspicion or doubt that they weren't a documented citizen. They could ask for their ID, and they could ask for paperwork or documents. And this kind of created, it did create a division with the Hispanic community and government in Arizona.
Okay,
because
and that happened to you?
That did happen to me, because me and my cousin, it was a Thanksgiving. We chose to walk. And like I said before, we were from a small town community. So the local law enforcement knew my family. We were walking down our dirt road, and he decided to pull over and stop and ask for mine and my cousin's IDs. And he ran them through, and he checked our status to make sure we were legal. And that in itself was racial profiling against me. He knew who my family was. We'd lived there for three generations. We were completely legal. And that didn't only happen to me, but it was happening to many others across the state. And it was very, very insensitive and very...
Well, how did that make you feel?
It made me feel belittled. It made me... realized that it was a huge problem. I went back and told my family about it. We couldn't really do much, because there were cases going on where citizens were suing the state, but because it was state legislation, it was a very hard battle. It was a very expensive battle for many individuals, so it was something that we just had to kind of brush off and go about our day.
And so how does that inform what you want to do in Kent County?
That made me feel, first of all, uncomfortable, even wanting to walk my own dirt road or streets back where I'm from. Mm-hmm. So just the individuals here, being on a much larger scale, they shouldn't feel uncomfortable walking their streets. Mm-hmm. They should feel like any other citizen or human being that's always lived here, comfortable walking their streets, going to the store, shopping. Shouldn't feel like they're pressed for any sort of information unless they're guilty of.
Okay. So I want to connect it back to like the policies that, you know, you said that you wanted to run on. So if law enforcement can pull you over and ask you for identification, right? The reason that the police frequently cite for that is that they want to know just who you are. They don't care if you're undocumented or not. They just want to make sure that you are who you say you are and that you're not a criminal, right? And so frequently they'll take them to the county jail here in Kent County and have them fingerprinted to identify them. And if Immigration, Customs, and Enforcement knows that they're here in this country and they lack documentation, then they'll be deported, right? So to determine people's identity, people are being taken to a county jail. And then the end result of that is that they're then deported. Whereas if the county had an ID program that provided, said, okay, this is who they say they are, and the police could ask for that identification, receive it, they wouldn't have to take them to the county jail. So you would basically remove the county jail entirely from this process of deportation that's been going on. So is that something that you would support, is a county-wide ID program for anyone that wants to get a county ID, they can get a county ID?
I do support a program that does establish something like that, and that was part of the whole educating our also our local law enforcement officers to help work with community members in this county.
Okay.
On a program such as that.
Okay. So would you also be in favor of not the county jail not cooperating with Immigration, Customs, and Enforcement outside of violent crimes?
Correct. As long as they don't have any incriminating behavior or any sort of violent history or past, there should be no reason why the local county jail should be cooperating with ICE.
So is it just incriminating? That's not exactly what I said, though. So somebody that has incriminating behavior could be anything, right, and could have any reason. But somebody that's facing charges for beating their wife or for killing somebody or for robbing a 7-Eleven.
Correct. Right? That would be definitely one of the ones. But if it was like a traffic violation or a speeding ticket, that should not.
Or somebody that was just brought in because they wanted to find out who they were, right?
Correct. That's not any sort of reasonable stance to have someone deported, especially if they're a working class and they have been paying into the tax system.
And they're contributing members of society.
Correct.
So how do you feel like you can help to bridge the gap between the Hispanic community and Wyoming and Granville at large?
I think the biggest way to bridge that gap is creating events that also center around the Hispanic community. Their voices aren't really heard. I mean, obviously there's the traditional 4th of July events and everything, but I think as long as we're hosting events too, with working with the city on creating events like Dia de los Muertos, doing something like that in the Wyoming community, doing maybe a Cinco de Mayo event, it doesn't even necessarily have to be a holiday. It can just be a centered event around Hispanic education for the community on a warm spring day or a warm summer day, that they could host it during Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and local businesses that are Hispanic, such as Tamales Mary or even Tacos El Corporal, they could have booths set up there to provide food for the community and sell their food, get their name out there a lot more. And even that's even inviting to some of the other local businesses as well, such as Marge's Donut, then getting their name out there and making the Hispanic community feel comfortable and knowing that they're supported in
their efforts. So that's how you can help the Hispanic community, but specifically how can you bridge the gaps, right? Like, it's not just inviting somebody to an event, but are there other ways you can bridge the gap between the two communities so that we can have more of an actual community here in Wyoming and in Granville?
I think possibly one of the possibilities doing that too is maybe doing like a town hall and educating people on and making these issues present and predominant. I think if you had some Hispanic people in the Hispanic community that did feel comfortable speaking about this, and like I said, at something like a town hall event, and letting them know what their concerns are, how they feel, I think that would definitely help kind of bridge that gap, inviting the local police department as well to participate in something like that. It's nothing that has to do with a swift decision. It's them hearing the community's voice, and it's them that are protecting these people, and it's them that they need to hear.
Okay, so I'd like to get back to, because we've basically touched on a lot of different ways that you can help change people's lives for the better as a county commissioner, and how the county commission in general should be serving the people. Back to that main point though, are there other ways that you feel like the county commission could or should be serving people? Or basically, why should I, as a regular person, pay attention to a county commission race or get involved or volunteer or door knock or even vote for a county commissioner? Why does it matter?
A big part that's missed out too is that the county commissioners also lobby their local state legislators. Mm-hmm. So their state elected reps, their state senators, We work with legislation that they're crafting, whether or not something to support. So anything that the state legislator and the state senate work on affects everything locally. Mm-hmm. And so I think one of the best examples of that is in the Elliot Larson bill. Mm-hmm. So if you have a local state legislator, a candidate's running for local state legislator that supports amending the Elliot Larson to include all aspects of the LGBTQ spectrum so that we're not discriminated in the workplace, that affects the county commission as well, because if you have county commissioners that are LGBTQ, they'd want to make sure that they're protected under government law as well, mm-hmm. Being in the workplace. And it also protects other individuals as well, not inside the government, working for their employers.
Okay.
So if you have a large representation of LGBTQ in your community, that's going to be something that they want to be represented on. That's going to be something that they want to ensure that they're protected, is making sure a bill such as that would be amended. So that's an importance of a county commissioner, is that ensuring that our people also feel safe in the community. So that's just one of the examples that where we would play a role in something like that as well, that people don't really realize.
Okay, cool. So what is your vision for a better Granville and Wyoming?
I think I would like to see more people active and engaged with the community. Mm-hmm. Obviously, I see it more so with the Granville area, but I think because of the way that our nation has headed, the Wyoming area has kind of been a mixed flavor of attitudes, being that it's a more diverse area than the Granville area. And living here, since I've moved here, I've noticed that people are a little bit less engaged and a little bit more reserved because of the way politics has been going. I want to see them being more comfortable. It doesn't have to necessarily even be politics, just being more active in their community, engaging with, feeling comfortable doing like community cleanup days, just city events like that that are promoted and put on. And even whenever they do some of their local fairs, I notice that the turnout a lot of times has been declining lately. So they should feel comfortable attending events like that. Even the local picnics, they should be comfortable going to. So I think as far as the future vision goes, I want to see the local elected officials and local city government making it more comfortable for members of the community to come out, letting them know that it's still fine, and being getting that equal representation as well into those local city offices. That way my community, the Hispanic community, can know that they're just people like them too, that serve on the government, that won't turn on them.
Are there any stories that you have of like your life here in Wyoming that you think is interesting that you want to share?
Whenever I moved up here, I started from the ground up. Mm-hmm. I moved up here with just 2 suitcases. And now, just maybe 6 years later, I own a house, own my own car, had 2 vehicles for a while. And I think I've seen it all as far as the struggles go. I've been homeless temporarily. I've gone through school and know the hardships of facing debt and having to work a full-time job while going to school full-time. I think being from a small town community as well, one of the things, I'm going from country to city is a completely huge turn. I'm not used to city buses, obviously. So when I first moved up here, I had, like I said, had nothing. So I was having to use the Rapid system, and the Rapid was in the process of improving a lot of its routes and everything, making new routes. So figuring that system out and learning what areas had construction, because of being Michigan, a lot of the roads are under construction. So working out timings with I basically would leave My house at about 6 or 7 in the morning for school. I had work throughout the day, and I, again, had the rapid as my only form of transportation. I'd be gone from 7 to maybe about 9, 10 at night, even though my classes were only 7 to 9, and work was maybe only 2 to 6, 2 to 7. You have to incorporate the transit time for transportation as well with the rapid. So that was another couple of hours involved with that. And that was just my everyday for about 2 years until I could get myself my own vehicle. And I've seen the hardships of trying to save money, trying to save on that dollar, especially going through, which thank God for the transit system, because back when I was using it, that's when gas was about $4 a gallon. Mm-hmm. So I think doing that, and then I got to see a lot of the community going through that and seeing how it was. I would walk to and from Grand Rapids Community College to where I lived over here in Wyoming. I got to see the old manufacturing neighborhoods that have closed down in the districts. I would always wonder, being from a country, we were always trying to think of ways to preserve buildings, ways to use them again to accommodate for current situations. And just seeing all those manufacturing neighborhoods, it kind of was disappointing to know that they were just abandoned and there, and just a ghost town. I noticed that walking from downtown GRCC all the way to my home in Wyoming, that you go through a variety of neighborhoods just in that span as well. You hit, if you're walking up Granville, you hit the heavily Hispanic community, and then in between there, there's a mix of the African-American community as well. And then you have more modern kind of hipster Grand Rapids whenever you hit downtown. Yeah.
Nice. Are there any other stories that you'd like to share about life here, about your experiences, and maybe how that has compelled you to run for office?
Some of my other experiences here were a major part. Like I said, I graduated high school with my certificate, my first 2 years of certificate completed in college, and also with my national certification for pharmacy and licensure. Healthcare has always been a huge issue for me, and it's been a major importance because of it impacting my family's life. They've always had healthcare issues aside from being healthy, but I've worked in pharmacy since I was 16, 17, so I've been at it about almost a decade now, and it's changed so drastically. I think one of my goals before I do retire is I want to see the cost of drugs go down. I want to work my way up high enough to where I can make an influential decision like that. Another part is that being that my grandmother worked with disabilities, I knew that obviously those individuals were on prescription medications, and I've obviously seen a lot being in the healthcare field. I mean, I worked for a CVS that did literally burn down because of poor standards and violations and codes. So I was involved with that. But at that particular location, I worked in Kentwood. So I saw a variety of races, individuals, disability. So everything from Vietnamese to Korean, Bosnian, and it was a different mix of people, but it was something that I enjoyed seeing. Mm-hmm. And being a healthcare worker, learning about some of their backgrounds and how their background would affect what they're taking or what they're on or what they had to be on. One particular story that hits me that I've always stayed in the healthcare field is that there was this individual girl. She was probably about my age, and at the time that was about 19 or 20. She had Down syndrome, but she would always come in, and she would always buy a coloring book every time she came in. And she would need some of her ADHD medications. She'd need some medications for seizing. And I'd make sure that I got that done as fast as possible for her so her caretaker wouldn't have to wait so long. One day she came in about 4 o'clock and it was about my time to go. I made sure that her things were taken care of and done, and once I had rang her up and everything, I timed out and I decided to get some food on my way out from work. She was at the front register while I was waiting in line. I was right behind her. She was purchasing 2 coloring books and scented markers and then a set of regular markers. She didn't have enough money from what her mother had given her to go with her caretaker. She only gave her really enough money for a little bit of food and her prescriptions, but she had that little bit of extra money to spend on some coloring books, and she didn't have quite enough to afford the scented markers. I decided to pay for the markers for her and the coloring books, and I think just that kind of a pay it forward was what meant the most to me, knowing that I saw her all the time. The next time I saw her, which was about a week later after that for some new stuff, she brought me in a colored picture and she wrote my name on it, and she said that she just thanked me for doing that for her because it did mean a lot, and she did have fun with the colored coloring books, and she did enjoy the scented markers because she said it made it more enjoyable for her to color those pictures. But she did color me a picture, and I hung that over where my cubby was in my work area because it was a reminder that even if I got yelled at by that angry customer, even if I got yelled at by that angry doctor, it was those individuals that made it worth healthcare for me. Because I was reconsidering it a lot of the time too, going into like maybe business or something. But it was that made me realize that I wanted to keep working in the field and keep doing retail. So, I mean, it devastated me when the fire happened and I lost that picture because it was of great importance to me. And I did kind of keep in touch with her caregiver to see how she was doing after that and everything. And she did wind up passing a couple of years later, but it still reminds me that no matter how hard my day may be in my job and career, that they're normal people too, and they appreciate what we do for them. And I also, going from retail, I work now at Mercy Health St. Mary's, which is also nonprofit. They do wonderful work in programs like the Backpack for Kids program. They also do, some of our pharmacists also participate with outside organizations where we still collect like clean toothbrushes, hygienical supplies for communities in Africa and have those shipped off. Sometimes we make it with departments where we do competitions and everything. Whoever gets the most backpacks and everything, we'll throw like a pizza party or something. But I think going from experiencing that to Mercy Health St. Mary's, I like how they support their community. I like how they put on a lot of the these events, and it's all nonprofit work that they do. And the care that's given around the people and the patients is extraordinary. We also created a part of, like how I said, the costs of drugs and medications. We work with our little community pharmacy as well at Wege with a 340B program. That's a huge reason why I decided that I did want to work with Mercy Health St. Mary's is because it's an affordable program for those that are either with no jobs or very low income and horrible insurance. It helps bridge that gap for them and provide them medications at little to no cost at all, really. And nothing's for free, but they do get it for a lot of the medications for no cost because of that funded program that we are providing for them.
Was there anything else you wanted to talk about?
I believe that's about all I have.
Great. I think we're all set.